What is the practical solution to avoid riba? Number one, our Prophet said, this hand is better than this hand. A janazah was brought to the Prophet for him to perform the Salatul Janazah. Janazah, it will be a dead body which has been given the washing, the ghusl, and which has been clothed. And the Salatul Janazah will be the prayer which is performed over that body before burial. So the Prophet has to perform the prayer, Salatul Janazah. He asked, did he leave any debts? They said no. He performed the prayer. Another janazah was brought for him to perform the Salatul Janazah. He asked, did he leave any debts? They said yes. Meaning, he left debts and did not leave enough money to pay the debts. The Prophet refused to perform the Salatul Janazah over that body because that man died with a debt. He said to his companions, you pray over him. Abu Qatada al-Ansari then said, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, O Messenger of Allah, I will pay the debt. Then the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam performed the Salatul Janazah over that body. My book on Dajjal and money, I'm working on it now. It is a revised version of my older book on riba, the prohibition of riba in the Quran. And so now give me a few months, inshallah, and this book will be ready. And in this book, I have all of these ahadith. So your first step is to stay out of debt. First step, stay out of debt. It is preferable to rent an apartment than to go and buy a house. When you rent the apartment, you're paying your landlord's riba for him. Yes. When you buy the apartment, you're paying the riba yourself. This one is the lesser evil, where you're paying his riba. This one is the greater evil, because you're paying it directly to the bank. So it is preferable to rent rather than to buy a house with a bank loan on interest. The next step that you must take is never borrow money on interest. Why? The Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, I sent this message to Imran Khan, you know. I made a video and I sent it to him. I don't know, maybe he's too busy to listen to me. Yes, I was looking forward. I said, I think because this man played cricket as an honest cricketer, he didn't cheat. Yeah, we admired it. I come from the land of cricket, Trinidad, land of Brian Lara. So I can appreciate a good cricketer who doesn't cheat. Huh? So I said, because Imran Khan played cricket in such a wonderful way, he'd make a better prime minister than all those vagabonds that were there before him. And I expected more from him. I didn't expect him to fail so quickly. No. Even Jeremy Corbyn didn't expect him to fail so quickly. Yes. So the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam cursed all four. And he said they're all equally guilty. The one who takes riba, the one who gives riba, you borrowed money in interest and you're paying the interest, the Prophet cursed you. The one who records the transaction and the two witnesses, and he said they're all equally guilty. So to go and borrow money on interest to buy a house, to buy a car, to do business, or to make a trip to Disneyland, and now even to perform the Hajj, is to get the curse of the Prophet upon you. So avoid it. If you live with the curse of the Prophet upon you, let me tell you what are the implications. You can perform your salat, it's not going anywhere. You can give in charity, it's not going anywhere. You can fast in Ramadan, it's not going to be accepted. You can go perform the Hajj, it will not be accepted if you have the curse of a Prophet upon you. These are the things that you can do at the beginning. Somebody wrote me 4 questions in one. What about using a bank account? Our Prophet said, when there is no escape from evil, if you turn to this side, it is evil, you turn to that side, it is evil. And that is the world of money today. He said, you must always choose the lesser of two evil. So what is the state of riba? Our Prophet said that the time will come when you'll not be able to find a single person, not one, in all of mankind, who will not be consuming riba. And whoever says he's not consuming riba, verily the dust of riba will be upon him. Verily the vapor of riba will reach him. So on the subject of money, there is no escape. So if you have a bank account, the sensible thing to do is to use your bank account as the lesser of two evils. That doesn't mean it's halal. And you do not keep in your bank account more money than you need for paying bills. That's all. Whatever other money you have, you take it out of your bank account and you put it into that which has intrinsic value, like buy gold and silver, or you can buy apples, you can buy dates, you can buy land, you can buy animals. And when that money falls in value, your money will not. I would not have been able to attend your event if I didn't ask a friend to book the ticket. Yes, I know. We are caught now in this system. You want to get a taxi? You have to call on the phone and you got to pay. You want to buy a ticket? It has to be done electronically. We are caught in this system now. And when you are caught in the system, do not use the system to promote yourself. Stay in the system as minimally as you can be. Minimal contact with the system, as minimal as possible, so that you can say, yes, I'm choosing the lesser evil, but I'm not profiting from it now. How does one provide for their family without contributing to riba? If you feed your children with riba money, you're putting fire in their belly. Yeah. Try your best as you can to avoid riba. How do we respond to someone who says that although riba is haram, it is beneficial to take a loan in order to invest in the country, in order to pay off the country's debts? If Allah has made something haram, no one can make it halal. However, there is the law of necessity, where if you do not have any food to eat, then you are facing death by hunger. The law, the Quran tells you, it is permissible for you to eat lahmul khazir, pork, as the lesser of two evils. But there are rules and regulations concerning eating the pork. Shall I tell you? Which apply to when you want to borrow money and interest. Number one, you will eat the minimum amount of pork to stay alive. So if you fill your plate with pork, shame on you. Look at the big house, and you go back to Pindi and you're showing off a full plate of pork. You're supposed to eat the minimum to stay alive. That's the law of necessity. Number two, when you're eating the pork, you must not be enjoying it. Licking your fingers. Huh? I'm only eating this to stay alive. But you have this big house and you're licking your fingers, you're enjoying the pork. Number three, while you're eating the pork, you're constantly looking for food. And as soon as you get the food, out with the pork. But you sign a contract for 25 years of pork. Yes, that's what you did. 25 years of pork. That's not the proper application of the law of necessity at all. A man who has a wife and 10 children, nobody wants to rent an apartment to him. He prefers to rent. Yes, he prefers to rent. He doesn't want to buy on loan and interest. But with his 10 children, nobody would rent to him. Nobody. And his family is going to be out in the sky, in the street. And he doesn't have anyone to help him. And this man, in order to avoid the situation of his family being on the street, he said, let me see if I can get a short-term loan on interest before I can get enough money to leave this country and go somewhere else. Okay? Here is a man who definitely has the law of necessity on his side. These people can be excused by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but not the others who lick their fingers. One more, how can we explain in the economy that moneylenders don't have the risk, usury? In fact, they have the risk if a person doesn't pay except for credit on gauge, How doesn't wealth circulate because of the riba? The bank is lending you money in a different way from me. If I have £20 in my pocket, can I lend you 40? Why are you so quiet? I have only £20 in my pocket, can I lend you 40? The bank has £20 in its pocket and the bank lending you 200. It's called fractional reserve banking. Huh? Is that business? Or is that wholesale theft? That's how the moneylender operates. I used to think that the bank was using from the £20 it had to lend. Until the head of the German Central Bank, who just retired, he explained the situation about a year or two ago. He says, no, the banks don't do that. The banks never lend you money from their coffers. No. Every time the bank lends money, the bank has to borrow from a central lending bank. You're not allowed to lend your own money. You have to borrow from them at that rate, and then you can lend at a higher rate. Where is the risk involved there? Huh? Tell me, where is the risk? I'm borrowing from him and lending to you. If you do not repay me, then I must have some collateral that I'll seize your house or I'll seize your car. The bank will not lend you money until there is some security. So where is the risk? Ah, yes, I know the risk. When Raja Sahab in Islamabad, and this big Nawab Sahab in Islamabad and so on, and they have friends in the bank, and they go to the bank and they borrow so many millions and millions and millions with no intention of ever repaying it. The bank has to say, it's a loss. The books have to show it's a loss. Because those people borrowed the money with no intention of ever repaying it. It's a scam. No, don't come with this. The banks take risk. They don't take risk. What happens if we want to purchase a property and you're unable to do so without a mortgage? What shall we do? This is the last question. I was in Long Island, and in order for me to get my American green card, I had to be the imam at a masjid. So for 1 year, I was imam at a masjid in Long Island to get the green card. Then after 9/11, I didn't bother about the green card anymore. And I gave a lecture on riba. A Pakistani pediatrics surgeon, who was making tons of money in Long Island, came to me. He said to me, Sheikh Imran, I've been in New York for 25 years now, and no one has ever lectured on this subject of riba. 3 weeks later, he came to me, he said, Sheikh Imran, all my riba, I've got rid of it. In 3 weeks, he did it all. So what to do with all the money he's making? This is what he did. He started buying houses around the masjid to families who wanted to live close to the masjid. And he said, you put 10% and I put 90. So the house was $100,000. And this man will put 10,000 and he would put 90,000. And so now there's a partnership. The house is owned by two parties. The partnership then signed a rental agreement. That the house will be rented to the smaller party with the 10%, but at the market rental value. And that the market rental value will be checked every 3 years, because rents can go up and down. And every month that he pays the rent, 10% of the rent comes back to him as 10% owner, and 90% goes to the doctor. All taxes and all maintenance and repairs are met by both parties based upon proportion of ownership. So if we have to pay $100 in maintenance, he will pay 10 and this fellow will pay 90. Good. Then the partnership signed a second agreement that the partner who owns less has the right to buy from the partner who owns more, so that his 10% can reach 20, can reach 30, but every time, this is called equity, every time he buys from the equity of his partner, it must be bought at the market value of the property. And that value can go up and down. And at the end of the transaction, he would have bought the whole house from him. There was no riba, none. You bought it for less money than if you bought it from the bank, because you cut out the part that the bank was going to take. And here was a system, and there were several houses right around the masjid in Long Island. Several houses were bought this way. There's a second way in which you could proceed. And that is that you get, say, 12 people and try to stay away from crooks. And each person will pay, say, £100 a month. £100 a month. And every month you'll get £1,200. Every month. And those who have a greater need will come at the top of the list. And those who do not have a great need will go at the bottom of the list. So it becomes an interest-free loan from those who have to those who don't have. Okay? And if you raise the amount sufficiently and you have a sufficiently large number, maybe every month you could be buying a house. Every 2 months you could be buying a house, provided you have a sufficiently large number of people and a sufficiently large amount of money paid every month. And this company operates free from riba, except that you're using the bogus money. That's all.